بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Today I will speak about the radiology of the acetabulum. In this lecture, we will be going through the basics of the anatomy or radiographic anatomy, and then we will speak about the radiology in disease cases and in traumatology. For simplification, think of the acetabulum as a cave, زي كهف. A cave consists of an anterior wall and a posterior wall with a roof as well as a floor or a medial wall. This child, to build up this cave, he has to first to apply a column and then build on it a wall. And that's exactly what's present in the acetabulum. You have an anterior column with a prominent anterior wall. You have a posterior column with a prominent posterior wall. So, complex bony acetabulum is no more complex. For simplification, think of it as a cave, as we said. Anterior wall protruding over an anterior column. Posterior wall protruding over a posterior column. These two columns and walls are connected by the dome. The medial part or the floor of the cave is the medial wall of the acetabulum. So the acetabulum is formed exactly like a cave with an anterior, superior, posterior parts. How to interpret this on an X-ray? The problem in you are trying to convert the area, for example, the area of the anterior anterior wall or column, to a line that this area represents on the X-ray. So let's go through each area separately. The medial wall, we will start with the medial wall. The medial wall is represented is represented by a line at the teardrop. This line anatomically should be slightly lateral to what we name the posterior column line or the ilio-ischial line. It should not be touching it or medially protruding over it. So that's the medial wall line. And this delineates or shows how much is the depth of the acetabulum. So if this medial wall is protruding, touching, or medially protruding beyond this line, so that means that the acetabulum is deep and the cave is deep. And that means that either you have a coxa profunda, a huge acetabulum, or a protrusio acetabulum, that means that the head is protruding into the pelvis. The second way to see the acetabulum depth is to see how much of the head is outside the acetabulum, what we name the extrusion index of the head. Normally, about 20% of the head should be uncovered to allow for a good range of motion. If this head is all sinking inside the acetabulum, that means that the acetabulum is huge and the head is sinking inside the cave. So, if we think about the acetabular depth abnormalities, that's the normal acetabulum. That's a shallow acetabulum. You can look and see how the head is uncovered. Most of the head is protruding outside the acetabulum. Exactly 50% of the head is protruding outside. And you can see how the floor is far away from the ilioischial line. On the other part, if we look at the depth of the acetabulum, you can see how the head is touching the ilioischial line and protruding beyond it. So that's what we name a deep socket or a huge acetabulum. ora protrusio acetabuloi. Superior wall, or the dome, or the superior covering part of the acetabulum. It corresponds to a radiographic line that starts and ends on the same level. This sclerotic area covering the head should start and end on two points on the same level. If you have a shallow acetabulum, so it will start and end in what we name a positive angle. But if you have an overcoverage or a head deep inside the socket, that means the acetabulum will be covering more of the head and it would end in a negative point. This is measured by using tonus angle or acetabular index. The normal acetabular index ranges from 0 up to 10 degrees positive. If you have more than 10 degrees, so that's an acetabular index showing a shallow acetabulum or a hip and an acetabular dysplasia. If you have a deep socket, so you will have a negative acetabular index, and this corresponds to what we name a pincer effect of femoroacetabular impingement. Another way of measuring the superior wall or the lateral coverage or the dome is measuring the lateral center edge angle. Taking a point in the center of the head with a vertical line going vertically upwards and another line going touching the lateral part or the lateral edge of the dome, an angle is measured in between. This angle should be between 25 and 40 degrees. If this angle is small, that means that the lateral edge is incomplete and the acetabulum is dysplastic. If this angle is more than 40 degrees, that means that the acetabulum is overcovering the head, and that means that we have a pincer femoroacetabular impingement. So, collecting all these data, assessment of acetabular depth is looking at the medial wall of the cave as well as looking at the lateral or the superior coverage or the dome. It can be done by measuring the medial or the floor line, the dome line, the angles of the acetabular index and the lateral central edge, as well as looking of how much of the head is covered and the extrusion index. Anterior and posterior walls. The relationship between the anterior and posterior wall is clear for all of us. They should not be on the same line because of the presence of what we name the acetabulum antiversion. The anterior wall is more anteriorly prominent than the posterior wall, with an angle of about 10 to 20 degrees, giving the acetabulum its normal antiversion angle. If we want to convert this to lines on the X-ray, to draw the anterior wall's line, we go with the inferior border of the superior pubic ramus and trace the radiographic line present, and that's the anterior wall line. While if you want to trace the posterior wall line, you go with the ischium and you go up and trace the radiographic line present in the hip joint. The relationship should be that these two lines only meets at the superior part. They should not meet before reaching the dome. In cases of retroverted acetabulum, if you trace these lines, they will meet before reaching the upper part or the dome of the acetabulum, creating what we name a figure of eight sign. as well as the posterior wall sign will be medial to the center of the head. It should usually be, the posterior wall line should usually coincide with the center of the head. Otherwise, this is a retroverted acetabular. Application of this on radiographs. This is a true pelvis radiograph. We first draw the center of the head by drawing the circle of the head, dividing it into two lines. The meeting point of these two lines is the center of the head. Once you get the center of the head, you start drawing the lines, the anterior wall line and the posterior wall line. So that's a normal relationship. The floor, and measure the extrusion index, and measure the lateral central edge angle, and measure the acetabulum index. This is another X-ray of another patient. If you look at the left hip, you will find that the floor is far away from the ilio-ischial line. The extrusion index is about 50%. Most of the head, half the head, is uncovered. If we look at the dome, you will find that it's opened laterally. That means that the acetabulum index angle is more than 10 degrees. If you look at the anterior wall line and the posterior wall line, you will find them that they are far medially from the center of the head. The second thing is that they cross over early. That means that you have a dysplastic retroverted acetabulum. This is another X-ray of a female patient, young adult, complaining of chronic hip pain for a long time. For the first look, you can notice that the hips are quite fine, but if you go and measure the angles, you will find that the dome is opened laterally with the positive acetabular index more than 10 degrees. And if you look more at the extrusion index of the head, you will find that about 40% of the head is uncovered bilaterally. And that's a case of a commonly missed diagnosis, which is what we name a borderline hip acetabular dysplasia. Now we will move to the second part of the presentation, which is understanding the radiology of fractures of the acetabulum. Anatomically, we have to understand that the pelvic bone is helical in shape. That means that the two columns, the anterior and posterior column, are in two different planes. The two planes are actually 90 degrees to each other. Any bone that you want to take an X-ray of it, usually we use an orthogonal view, which is directing the beam at 90 degrees to the plane of the bone. If you look at the AP view of the pelvic bone, you will find that actually it's not a 90 degrees view to the columns, anterior and posterior. And that's why the AP view is not enough to properly show the two parts of the acetabulum. Moving the beam 45 degrees outwards or inwards, to get a 90 degrees or an orthogonal view of each column is obligatory. And that's the basics of having three views for the acetabulum, two oblique views and an AP view to understand the fracture pattern. These are the three views of the acetabulum that we usually use. The AP view, with the patient lying on his back. The 45 degrees internal oblique view, and a 45 degrees an external oblique view. This view, what we name the obturator oblique, because it shows properly the obturator foramen, and the other view is what we name the iliac oblique, because it shows properly the posterior column view or the iliac wing view. Actually, a 45 degrees internal oblique is a 45 degrees external oblique on the other side. So the obturator oblique view on the left hemipelvis is an iliac oblique view of the right hemipelvis, and vice versa. Thinking again of an acetabulum as a cave supported by two columns, anterior and posterior. Long time ago, Letourneau and Judet, they defined six lines to identify different parts of the cave in the three views, the AP, iliac, and obturator view. Going through these radiographic lines, transferring each part to a line on the X-ray. Iliopectineal line corresponds to the anterior column. So if you have a discontinuity of the iliopectineal line at any level, that's an anterior column fracture. Ilioischial line, which starts at the greater sciatic notch and goes down on the medial border of the ischium, delineates the posterior column of the acetabulum. Posterior rim, which corresponds to the posterior wall. Anterior rim, which corresponds to the anterior wall. So that's a four lines corresponding to the anterior columns and the walls of the acetabulum. Speaking about the roof line, which starts and ends at the sclerotic area at the upper part of the acetabulum, the superior wall or the roof or the dome, it corresponds to this area, which is the weight-bearing portion of the acetabulum. The last line is the teardrop, and the teardrop, to understand it more, it's two lines corresponding to the two levels of the medial floor. We have the acetabulum medial or medial wall or floor formed of two lines in two depths. The first depth corresponds to the orange line, which is the medial part or the inner aspect of the lunate cartilage. And the other line, which is the yellow line, corresponding to the bony part of the medial wall or the pelvis. That's why these two lines appears as two lines giving the appearance of a teardrop. So the teardrop corresponds to the medial wall. By adding the roof and the teardrop to the lines, we have six radiographic lines corresponding to different areas of the acetabulum. Obturator oblique view. This is done by turning the patient 45 degrees internally. The best view is identified radiographically by having the anterior superior and posterior superior iliac spines on the same point. And this will show the biggest part or the biggest possible portion of the obturator foramen. On the obturator oblique view, you can identify four fundamental landmarks. Of course, the anterior column and the obturator foramen, the posterior wall, and the anterior part of the roof. This is an obturator oblique view of a patient showing a fracture of the posterior wall and a transverse fracture with a discontinuity of the anterior column. Iliac oblique view. This is done by turning the patient 45 degrees externally. And the best possible view of the iliac oblique shows a full picture of the greater sciatic foramen and nothing of the obturator foramen. Three fundamental landmarks can be identified on this view. Of course, the posterior column, the iliac wing, and that's why it's named an iliac oblique, and the anterior wall. Speaking about the dome concept, the dome, as we said, is the superior part or the weight-bearing part of the acetabulum. And it's our target to reduce and fix the acetabulum anatomically, especially the dome part. Matta defined the roof arc in 1986 to be more than 45 degrees in all three views. However, Mark Verhaus from the US revised this concept in 1999, and he said that the posterior roof arc is much, much, much more important than the anterior roof arc. So what's the roof? What's the dome? That's the dome. Imagine that you have a dome and you're drawing it with a compass. So you put a center and then you rotate 45 degrees or 60 or 70 degrees with an open angle, circular, to draw this dome. And that's what we do on the X-ray, getting the center of the acetabulum, anterior part, posterior part, draw the dome. The medial roof arc angle is measured on an AP view, while the anterior roof arc is measured on the obturator oblique view, while the posterior roof arc is measured on the posterior the iliac oblique view. Another sign, if we see it on the X-ray on the obturator oblique view, that is diagnostic of what we name as sheeted both columns, because actually when you turn the patient internally 45 degrees, if this acetabulum is not connected to the main iliac crest part, this pelvis, this acetabulum will turn all through, showing the spur in the obturator oblique view. And this is diagnostic, as I said, for the associated both columns or ABC. Seagull sign. This can be shown clearly if you have a dome impaction. So if you see the roof, the seagull sign in any view, that means that you have what we name a roof impaction sign. The roof has been impacted and is seen at two different levels. CT scan. CT scan is exactly that you're taking different cuts of different part of the acetabulum. So if we are taking axial cuts, the dome of the acetabulum, or what we name the supraacetabular area, will appear like this. The dome of the acetabulum, or the upper part of the roof, will appear like this. The middle of the acetabulum will appear like this in a CT scan. Acetabular axial cuts should be taken as narrow as possible, with a maximum distance in between 2 to 3 millimeters. If we look at the CT cuts of the whole pelvis and go through it, so cut number one shows the posterior superior iliac spine. Cut number two shows the anterior superior iliac spine. Cut number three shows the sacroiliac joint, greater sciatic notch. Anterior inferior iliac spine and starting of the pelvic brim. Then we start seeing the head, and that's the upper part, or what we name the supraacetabular cut. Once you start seeing the shadow of the head, that's the beginning of the dome. So cut number 6 is the beginning of the dome. And then you see the acetabulum, upper part, middle part, inferior part, with the arrow pointing towards the anterior, towards the ischial spine. And then you see the ischium, and finally you see the symphysis obturator foramen at the end. So if we want to look at the acetabulum in all these cuts, we will look at cuts from number 6 till 12, just above the acetabulum till the end of the ischium. Interpretation of these CT cuts. So that's the column, anterior and posterior, and the wall starts in the middle and in the acetabular cuts. So that's the anterior column and that's the posterior column. So if we divide it into a separate line, what's behind the line is a column and what's anterior to the line is the wall. So wall fracture lines, column fracture lines, transverse fracture being at two different levels appears as a vertical line from anterior to posterior. A CT scan is also helpful in appearance of a marginal impaction, femoral head injuries, loose fragments, as well as the judgment of the congruency of reduction, as well as better delineation of an undisplaced fracture. It's very important in post-operative reduction assessment. And in post-operative reduction assessment, we use usually the axial cuts as well as the coronal cuts. A three-dimensional CT scan is a very helpful tool if done properly. It shows the pelvis in a three-dimensional views. It even can compensate for improperly done iliac and obturator views. Finally, if you want to measure or to look at the roof arc on a CT scan, just look at the cuts that corresponds to the upper or the highest 1 centimeter in the acetabulum, which corresponds to the dome. If they are normal, so your dome is intact. Thank you very much for watching.